Ascent TV is proud to present Faith Collective, presented by Sheikh Hanif Mohammed.
Assalamu alaikum, and welcome to another installment of the Faith Collective. I am Hanif Mohammed, and I'm your host. This is a show where we help Muslim brothers and sisters with their dawah issues. On the last episode, we discussed something that separates the Christians from the Jews and the Muslims, and this was the concept of the original sin. As you would remember a few episodes back, I told you that the Christians really wanted to have that information coming to them from the Bible. But if you're able to present to them the case or the evidence that we had showed last week on last week's episode, now you're able to introduce them to what the Quran has to say about this original sin concept. Now, what we're going to do is we're going to take the Bible verses that we reviewed on the last episode, and we're going to compare them to verses from the Quran that somewhat mirror those verses. Now, the Quran has more information about this, so there are going to be verses that we're going to discuss from the Quran that's going to give us a better understanding of Allah's mercy that we weren't able to deal with from the Bible. Just like in the last episode, we began first with the command not to eat from the tree. Now, what I'm going to do is we're going to show you the verses from the Bible, and we're going to put the verses from the Quran right beside it. And in an effort to conserve time, I'm only going to read the verses from the Quran, inshallah. So let's begin with the command not to eat from the tree. The Holy Quran says, O Adam, dwell you and your wife in the garden. So eat from where you desire, but do not go near this tree, for then you will be of the unjust. What we find here is that if we was to compare this verse with the verse from the Bible, from this onset, it looks like they're pretty much the same, but there are subtle differences that we will discuss at this time. Number one, the punishment from eating of the tree in the Bible says, if you eat of it, on that day you'll die. In the Quran it says, if you eat from the tree, you'll become unjust. In the Quran it says, do not go near the tree. In the Bible it says, do not eat of the tree. These are the subtle differences. Now, just like we did in the Christian and Jewish perspective, we gave the commentary from those respected rabbis or priests, whether they're Jewish or Christian. We'll do the same here with the Islamic point of view. And we're going to take the commentary on this verse from Ayatollah Puya. He says that the command was not to go near the tree. People not knowing the logical aspect of the wording of the command hold Adam a sinner for having eaten the forbidden fruit. The point is that the command was not to go near the tree, and there is nothing in the wording of the divine command to say that it was openly or definitely forbidden also to eat of the tree. Adam, in obedience to the divine command, did not go near the tree, but when the fruit of the tree was brought to him and he was induced to eat of it, he no doubt, instead of abstaining from eating the fruit of the forbidden tree, had of it. Adam can never be termed as a sinner who disobeyed the Lord, although his eating of the tree makes him liable to the natural consequences of eating the fruit of the forbidden tree. Now, this becomes very important, because here, those of us who follow the Ahlul Bayt, we say that Adam is not a sinner, where there are other Muslims that say that Adam did sin. But according to Ayatollah Puya, because Adam didn't go near the tree, the fruit was brought to him, he's not a sinner. Let me put that in layman's terms for everybody that's here watching now. The best way to describe it is, we as parents, we tell our children, hey, don't go near that iron, because we know the consequences of going near that iron. Here, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala tells Adam not to go near the tree. But let's say someone picks up your child and takes him over by the iron. He's over by the iron and he burns himself. When it comes time to punish the child, would you punish the child? Or would you call him a disobedient child? No, you don't call him that. But your child gets burnt, and there's consequences to getting burnt. When you get burnt, you're hurt, you're sore, and you're going to be sore for a long time. Those are the consequences of being burnt. Adam's burning for eating the fruit was actually he brought man into this world of trial and error. Not that all men were created sinners, but he brought us into this world of trial and error. Now, the next things that we dealt with in the Christian and Jewish perspectives was the position of the serpent or the Satan, as the Christians would say. Now, the Quran gives us verses that kind of mirror those verses. So what I'll do again is I'll show you both verses just to keep your mind fresh on what the Bible says. And now introducing you to what the Quran says, we'll have both sets of verses up next to one another. And I'll only read from the Quran. The Quran reads thusly. But Shaitan made an evil suggestion to them that he might make manifest to them what had been hidden from them of their evil inclinations. And he said, your Lord has not forbidden you this tree, except that you may not both become two angels, or that you may not become of the immortals. And he swore to them both, most surely, I am a sincere advisor to you. Then he caused them to fall by deceit. So when they tasted of the tree, their evil inclinations became manifest to them. This is a very, very, very important verse. What it shows here is that it was the Shaitan, it was the devil, it was Lucifer, who was the one who took Adam and Eve off of the true path. And unlike in the Bible where the serpent says to them, hey, look, if you eat of this tree, you'll be like God. The Shaitan knew in the Quran that Adam and Eve already understood that they could never be like Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. They saw the angels. They saw the other beings there in heaven. But they never saw Allah. All they knew was that Allah had power over all things. So the Shaitan, in his deception, he says to Adam and Eve that if you eat of this fruit, you become immortals or you become like the angels. But we have a problem here. And it was a problem that was asked in the last installment. And that problem is, if this was a serpent, how did the serpent become so crafty? How did he become so knowledgeable? What was his problem with Adam and Eve to where he wanted them to disobey their Lord? The Bible didn't give us any answers for that, but the Quran does. Now, in order for me to give you a good history, we have to go back to the beginning. And the Quran says, we said to the angels, prostrate to Adam. So they did prostrate except Iblis. He was not of those who prostrated. He said, what hindered you so that you did not prostrate when I commanded you? He said, I am better than he. Thou hast created me of fire, while thou hast created them of dust. What's important here is that now we know that there's something happening in heaven. There was a command given by Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And the first to disobey the command was actually Iblis. And Iblis is just a proper name for Satan. Iblis decided that he didn't want to obey his Lord. And because he didn't want to obey his Lord, there was something that happened. Now, according to this verse, I'll give you the commentary again from the Quran, just like we would, like we did from the Bible. And this commentary this time is coming from Allama Tabatabai. And he says, Imam Musa Kadhim, alayhi salatu wasalam, said concerning this, Allah created Adam, and he remained for 40 years in that shape, in a statue without life. And Iblis, again, proper name for Shaitan in the Quran, the curse, used to pass by him and say, Why have you been created? Then Iblis said, If Allah ordered me to prostrate before this, I would certainly disobey him. Then Allah said to the angels, Prostrate before Adam. All of them prostrated, but Iblis showed the envy that was in his heart, and he refused to prostrate. Now we have something. Now we're beginning to understand. Number one, Satan disobeyed Allah. But why did he disobey Allah? Because he saw the creation of Adam. He saw Adam when he was in his form without life. And he would go up to Adam and he would say, Why have you been created? What are you doing here? And then in his heart, he makes his intentions known. And Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala knows all things. So he knew it was in the heart of Shaitan at this time. And Shaitan said, If Allah makes me bow down to them, I'll never do it. So because of this, Shaitan was dismissed from the garden. And this is a this answers another question. Remember in the last episode, we asked, when was the Satan dismissed from heaven? The Bible left us out there without any answers. But the Quran tells us here, and it reads thusly. He said, Get forth from this state, for it does not befit you to behave proudly therein. Go forth, therefore surely you are of the wretched ones. And Satan said, Respite me until the day when they are raised up. Now, this is very beautiful. This is very beautiful. Because right now we know that Shaitan was thrown out of the garden by Allah. We know why he was thrown out of the garden. But then Shaitan says something very, very, very important. He says to Allah, he asks him, Give me respite, give me time. Why was the Shaitan asking for time? The Quran answers this beautifully also. The Quran says, Satan said, As thou hast caused me to remain disappointed, I will certainly lie in wait for them in thy straight path. Then I will certainly come to them from before them and from behind them and from their right-hand sides and from their left-hand side. And thou shalt not find most of them thankful. What happens here is that Shaitan answers the question. He asks for respite so that he could take man off of the straight path. Now, there's something that you have to remember here. Adam and Eve, before they had partaken of the fruit, all of this has happened prior to that. But the Shaitan makes reference here that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has a straight path. So that meant that before Adam and Eve had actually partaken of the fruit, that there was a straight path already established. Now the Shaitan said that he was going to come from the front of man where he could see, where we could see him, from behind us where we can't, from our right-hand sides and from our left-hand sides. He's basically crucifying man. Not like a man on the cross, but he's coming at us from all directions. And because of this, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala tells us that we have an open and avowed enemy. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala warns Adam and Eve of who their enemy is. He says in the Quran, When we said to the angels, Prostrate yourselves to Adam, they prostrated themselves, but not Iblis. He refused. Then we said, O Adam, verily, this is an enemy to thee and thy wife. So let him not get you both out of the garden, so that thou art landed in misery. Now here we have a problem. In the Bible, Adam and Eve, especially Eve, was never told that there was going to be a creature in the garden that was going to be there to deceive her. This is a problem. If God is truly just, then he can't be just if he didn't tell Adam and Eve that it was a creature there that was going to try to push them off the straight path. But the Quran answers this for us. The Quran lets us know that both Adam and Eve were warned not to follow the Shaitan, to stay as far away from him as they possibly could. And not only that, but Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, he forewarns them of the consequences, what the consequences would be for following the shaitan. The Quran says, he said, get out of the state, despised, driven away. Whoever of them follow you, I will certainly fill the hell with you all. Did I not forbid you both from that tree and say to you that Satan, shaitan, is your open enemy? In this verse, in the first verse, Adam and Eve were there when the shaitan refused to bow before Allah. Eve refused to obey the command of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala and make obeisance to Adam. They were there. So they heard when Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala say, any of them, meaning mankind, that follows you, I'm going to fill the hellfire with you and them. They knew the consequences beforehand. And along with the shaitan, he says to them, he warns them that the shaitan is an open enemy to them. Now, because the shaitan was able to come in and he was able to deceive Adam and Eve, then now Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has to make them suffer the consequences of their actions. And Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala gives us those consequences in the Quran. We said, get ye down, all of you, with enmity between yourselves on earth. On earth will be your dwelling place and your means of livelihood. The shaitan's punishment was, he said, then get forth from this state, for it does not befit you to behave proudly therein. Go forth, therefore, surely you are of the abject ones. Here, what we reminded of is that, number one, the consequences that Adam and Eve had mirror the consequences of the Bible's description of what happened to Adam. That was that he was going to be here on earth, because Adam wasn't created to be in the garden. He was created to be here on earth. Because he went towards this tree, the consequences meant that he had to come to this earth, and that he would start the trial and error for men and women until the day of judgment. Now, what more of a punishment do you need? Adam and Eve didn't have to hunt for food. They didn't have to break the ground. Everything was given to them. They were living in the lap of luxury. Now, the punishment that the shaitan had received was that he was made one of the abject ones. Abject means those who are doomed, those who have no hope. But the shaitan, remember earlier, he asked for respite. And in this respite, he says, if you allow me to stay here, I'm going to come at them from the front where they can see me, from the rear where they can't see me, and from the right side and from the left side. This is far different from the punishments that we found in the Bible. Because in the Bible, it speaks of the serpent being punished. And it speaks about Eve being punished. And please, for those of you that didn't watch last week's episode, please go back and watch it as a reference to see how women were looked at in Christianity because of this punishment that she received in the Bible as compared to the punishment that Adam and Eve received here in the Quran. now, because of this, there's something else that happened in the Quran that didn't happen in the Bible. Adam and Eve did wrong. But what did they do? They asked Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala for forgiveness. The Quran says of this, they said, "Our Lord, we have been unjust to ourselves. If thou forgive us not and have not mercy on us, we should certainly be other losers." We don't have any verses like this in the Bible. Adam and Eve, when they sinned, according to the Bible, that was it. They got punishment, and God did not give them a way to be reconciled back with them. Now, in the last episode, we talked about how the Jews felt about Genesis chapter 4, verse 7, where God is speaking to Cain. But again, that's Cain. That's Adam's son. This information wasn't given to Adam. Just as a reminder, the Bible, Genesis chapter 4, verse 7, reads thusly, "Surely, if you improve yourself, you will be forgiven. But if you do not improve yourself, sin rests at the door. Its desire is toward you, yet you can conquer it." Our Jewish brothers of this verse shows where Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is merciful. He says that sin is around all of us, but we can conquer it. The only problem is, from the Bible's perspective, he never showed them how to conquer the sin. But Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala shows us in the Quran that he is the most merciful. And he shows us this because the Quran reads thusly, "Then Adam received some words from his Lord, so he turned to him mercifully. Surely he is oft returning to mercy, the merciful. We said, go forth from this day all, so surely there will come to you guidance from me. And whoever follows my guidance, no fear shall come upon them, nor shall they grieve. And as to those who disbelieve in and reject my communications, they are the inmates of the fire. In it they shall abide." Here's what Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala tells Adam. He says, go from this state, go from the garden, and I'm going to send you words from me. Now, our commentary says that the way that Adam was actually, was the way that he was forgiven was because Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has showed him the Holy Five. He showed him the Prophet Muhammad. He showed him Imam Ali. He showed him Lady Fatima. He showed him Imam Hassan. He showed him Imam Hussein. May the peace and blessings of Allah be upon them all. And this was the way of them becoming forgiven. But what Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala also does is, he says, I'm going to give you a word for me. And I'm going to give you my communications or my signs. The word ayat in the Quran means sign. But in this particular verse, it means I'm going to send you prophets. And after the prophets, I'm going to send you imams to keep you on the right path. This is why our a'ima is so important. We must understand the walayat of our imams, because without that, we miss salvation. But Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala also gives us a warning. He says, for those who will not accept my communications, that they'll be in the fire. This is a consequence of us not obeying our Lord. Now, as before, I said, with the Christians, it wouldn't be good to give them the information from the Quran. But, like I said, if you talk to them and you show them that the Bible doesn't actually teach what it is that they believe in, then you could give them the correct perspective, and they will want to come towards Islam. Now, if you like this show, and if you like the information that you've gotten from this show, what I ask all of you to do is Send in your comments. And if there's more information that you want to know about, send it in. We like the information. Send it to us and we'll reply to you. Give us your dialogues that you have with Christians, with Jews, and we'll share your successes. Or if you have problems with it, we'll help you to become successful. As always, it's okay to say, I don't know. Imam Jafar Sadiq, when asked a question, it's okay to say, I don't know. Imam Jafar Sadiq, alayhi salatu wasalam, has said, half of knowledge is to say, I don't know. This shows humility and knowledge. And in order to do da'wah, we have to show this humility, because given knowledge is the key to da'wah. And as always, as the Sahaba of Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa alayhi wa sallam will leave each other with Asr, I leave you with Suratul Asr, inshaAllah. Bismillahir Rahmanir Rahim, wal Asr. Inna al-insana lafi khusr. Illa ladina aminu wa amilu salihat. Wa tawassab bil haqqi wa tawassab bis sabr. Shukran jazeela. Assalamu alaikum wa rahmatullahi wa barakatuh.
يا رسول الله ونبينا محمد يا رسول الله ونبينا.
Copy, duplication, distribution and broadcast of this program is strictly prohibited by law without the express written consent of Ascent TV. All rights are reserved to Ascent TV. For more programs like this, visit us online at www.ascenttv.net. والسلام عليكم ورحمة الله وبركاته.